Weekdays, TBS gives you an extra period with those fabulous kids from Bayside High.
Do you know how long that is in teen years?
Yes, it's 1 hour. Back-to-back Saved by the Bell, beginning at 5:05 Eastern weekdays on TBS.
And I wake up in the morning and the alarm is at a warning. I don't think I'll ever make it on time.
The Bayside Mystery Machine pulls up to a Scooby-Doo, Vincent Price-inspired mansion where Screech immediately quivers, leaping into Slater's arms. Hail, Scooby! No, this isn't your ordinary haunted mansion. It's all part of the Murder Mystery Weekend giveaway that Lisa won for the entire group.
Welcome to Knockwood Manor. I am your host, Stephen Jameson III.
And I am your guest, Zack Morris, the only...
Congratulations, Lisa. I hope you will all enjoy our murder mystery weekend.
Let's get on with it.
So that's what we are going with here, eh, writers? The old house on Haunted Hill angle featuring creepy adults.
So where's the corpse? Where's the body?
She just walked in.
Aw, that's just another day in the Bayside neighborhood.
Hello.
They arrive at Northwood Manor, where they are greeted by their host, maybe their ghost, host, Stephen Jameson III. He's really to hold on to his fake British accent, but failing miserably at it.
I'm sure you will all enjoy playing detective as our murder mystery unfolds.
Stephen is accompanied by his equal horrifying butler, Bartholomew, whom eagerly requests for Lisa's presence.
Murder mystery weekend.
Stephen alerts the gang that the first person to solve the whodunit mystery will take home the $500 prize, but he warns everyone to suspect everyone and trust no one. Jeanette, the French maid, flirts with Victor, the piano player, and practically salivates over Zack Morris.
Will I be seeing you later tonight?
Perhaps oui. Perhaps no.
I hope no for him and oui for me.
She's a little out of your league. The underage shit on this show is cancerous.
Your ginger ale, cola, and mango tonic with a kiwi twist.
Stephen dismisses Jeanette away so he can have a go at the 10-foot-tall roadblock.
You, my beauty, I'd play the minute waltz in 30 seconds.
Try sliding down that pole, huh? Jeanette gets jealous and pours a drink in Jessie's lap. That's enough to sharpen her claws and have a kitty cat spat until Stephen steps in between them.
Oh, I would like to apologize. I would like to rip off your little French nose. Pardonnez-moi?
Victor, take my drink.
He then gives Victor the drink, which he tries to brush off to the side like no one would notice.
Jeanette, get me another drink, quickly.
Alcohol? What's that? It's not in my vodka cabulary, but let me check one moment in my Whiskeypedia. Stephen lights his cigarette and the Bayside bunch are now quick to pass judgment on his smoking in his own estate.
You know, smoking's really bad for your health.
Yeah, and our health too. Secondary smoke is deadly.
Honestly, how dare you lecture a host in his own estate on the dangers of cigarette smoking right when he was about to get to this funny point? If you don't like it, then butt out.
I hate to say I told you so.
Ever since the Johnny Dakota episode, anti-drug sensitivity has gotten completely self-righteous to the extreme.
Right! Yes! Somebody is finally dead.
Victor suddenly clutches his throat and is now dead. So if you have been consciously awake up to now, you already know who did it. But let's pretend it's a mystery for the slow learners at heat.
You're so insensitive, Zack. How'd he die? How'd he die?
Well, he grabbed his throat before he croaked, so I guess someone...
Oh, he strangled himself to death.
In the estate men's room, Jeanette comes in and wants to offer Zack a complimentary in-house inspection.
I'd like to make you more comfortable. May I fluff your pillow?
Oh, fluff away.
Wink, wink.
Man, it's really hot for Zack.
Well, at least we have Identity, the town whore that has been sleeping with everyone.
Come on, Screech, it's only a game. She's just acting.
Oh, good thing, too.
She's a lousy maid.
Wasn't this the same mansion Bart Simpson uncovered as a dollhouse brothel?
La la, Zachary. Oh, you are so adorable.
Then at dinner, oh God, whom should creep but doing his lousy impersonation of Peter Cushing as Inspector Stereotypical Holmes.
Elementary, my dear Zachy boy. Sherlock Screech at your disposal. I was thrown at first, but now I know who did it. The stable boy.
There is no stable, you dork.
Isn't he outrageous enough as he is? Why can't they find something creative for him to do other than act as a dumb shit?
Ah, then the dog lied.
Okay, so he claims he is Sherlock Holmes while he walks around spouting off Dick Tracy random detective phrases. Well then, if he is so confident, astute, and sure of himself like the real Inspector Holmes would be, then why is he paranoid acting like he will be the next victim? When he wasn't poisoned with the glass of water, he continues to kill us all slowly, but not satisfying. Zack believes that it was Bartholomew whom killed Victor so he could finally have some time away from home with Jeanette.
Then whoever poured Jameson's drink must be the killer.
See what happens when you stab someone in the back in the name of sex? You get screwed. Jeanette arrives with Inspector Piccadilly D, Piccadilly Do, straight out of Scotland years, hot on the scene, to amp up the investigation.
Quiet, Jameson! There's work to be done.
If I can be so geographical correct, sir, I believe California is a wee bit outside the jurisdiction for Scotland Yard.
Mm-hmm.
Piccadilly interrogates Screech, and he kneels over like the cunt he is and confesses to pretty much everything.
I'm innocent, I tell you! I didn't do it, I'm innocent! All right, I confess I did it!
Zack Morris quickly butts in to the rescue.
I didn't do anything, you twink. Look, sir, we were all in the dining room.
Come on, Zack! The punishment fits the crime. Let him confess to the murder. Lock him up and throw away the key. This is the greatest moment ever that could keep him from invading Saved by the Bells, the new class. Help us, Obi-Wan. Zack Kenobi, you're our only hope. Then, in typical Agatha Christie fashion, lights dim out and poof, Inspector Piccadilly has been murdered by Chief Wahoo and the Cleveland Indians.
I don't believe this. Now we'll never know who the killer is.
But he just told us.
Typical. Pointless, stupidless, cheap, quick acting death ever. Ever.
All we have to do is find out whose real name is Arr.
Suddenly, an old woman arrives to report her necklace has been stolen.
My necklace! Someone has stolen my diamond necklace!
What?
Whoa there, Stephen. Theft wasn't part of the script. Stick to the senseless murder plot.
That's not part of the script!
What, you mean this isn't part of the game?
No.
Lisa is quick on the mark and saves Steven from being axed when he also mentions that was not a part of the script.
Oh!
Right, Mr. Jameson? You were almost the next victim.
Oh, come on, it was planned.
No, that was not part of the game. Lisa, thank you so much for saving my life.
Oh, would you please cut it out? I mean, come on.
Oh, it was no big deal.
Steven then appears to call it quits and asks Zack and the others to leave the game before someone gets hurt while they stop by his office for a free voucher.
Oh,
thank you.
Oh, Mr. Jameson. Since I did make the best guess, don't you think I should get a part of that prize money?
The axe must have been a metaphor for this whole entire time to be one RIP off.
Good point.
The gang all head to their rooms to pack their suitcases while Zack is taking more time than usual when Lisa knocks into his suitcase.
Will you hurry up? There is a real killer on the loose! Let's get out of here!
She She obviously can't be that clumsy, probably just doing her random gravity checks. The rest of the gang leaves the room, and Lisa offers to help Zack pack his suitcase while he goes to search for the vouchers.
Are you sure you're gonna be okay alone?
Yeah, I'll be fine.
For extra security, he locks the door on the way out to prevent the murderer from getting in. I have a feeling, Zack, your guardian angel often looks like this.
You're a thief and a murderer!
Zack then makes his way into Steven's office and later finds it ransacked with everything all scattered about. Steven claims someone has come looking for the prize money and offers Zack an envelope.
Thanks. Hope everything turns out okay. Good luck.
I don't think the envelope jumped to conclusions. I believed he was pushed into it, suggesting a dilemma.
How to get these vouchers for a free weekend?
Flee? Your Jameson is so cheap, he steals towels from his own hotel.
Oh, these aren't vouchers. This is money.
Money.
Again, with the cliches again. Why is that old mansions have faulty electrical systems incapable of controlling dramatic effects?
Mr. Jameson? Oh yeah, that was a good one. Mr. Jameson, come out, wherever you are. Mr. Jameson? Oh!
What happened?
Well, Mr. Jameson was here a minute ago and then he sort of vanished.
The hotel and the rest of the Bayside gang arrive to find Zack still in the Stevens office.
What are you doing here?
Yeah, I thought you were packing. No, Lisa's packing. I just came by to get these vouchers for a free weekend.
Zack is probably faced with 99 problems, and the money could solve at least 73 of them.
How did that get in there?
You stole the prize money.
I'm calling the real police.
The cops show up, and my God, these imposters are so fake that even China denied them they ever made them.
I didn't. I mean, I didn't do anything.
Take it easy, Darren. He's just a kid.
You know, this whole thing is a setup. I just came here to play a stupid game.
At this point, if you haven't guessed who the murderer is, then it's pretty obvious you won't survive through life by your wits alone.
When has Mr. Jameson disappeared? It stopped being a game.
Yes, and I want my necklace back.
Oh.
The old woman arrives with the missing necklace that earlier beat Zack Morris over the head. Like the fellow once said, ain't that a kick in the head? Wow, am I surprised how progressive the detectives grill Slater, Kelly, Jessie, and Screech as to what kind of individual Zack Morris is.
Well, he's the most honest person I know. Well, unless you count the time that he sold fake IDs at school. Zack's never really done anything wrong. Except the time he kind of, sort of stole our principal's car. But he gave it back.
I know Zack pretty well, and the last thing he would do is steal. Although, you know, there was that one time where he kidnapped Valley's mascot, but they deserved it.
Jack's my best friend. I've written down everything we've done together. See.
If you believe your friend Zack Morris is only in a dire situation now, then I previously recommend you rehash the earlier episodes into this criminal mastermind at work, starting with his foray into promoting prostitution in the Lisa Card episode. Which begs with the question, do the writers want Zack out as soon for season 4? Zack recalls having Lisa locked in the room and they all go look for her.
You know, Jameson told her about the vouchers too. She'll tell you what really happened.
Well then, let's go find Lisa.
They find the bedroom was empty and the detectives assume Zack had done wrong to Lisa.
Yes, I can see that, Slater. Look, I locked the door from the outside.
This is my cup of how much I care at this point. Ooh, look, it's empty.
No. See, what I mean is, she couldn't have gotten out.
Oh, Zack.
But I am telling you, I left her here packing my suitcase.
They do find the old woman's necklace in Zack's suitcase, and Lisa, watch in this pocket, though.
My necklace!
Ouch! How did that get in there?
Zack, I'm afraid we're going to have to search you.
Oh, sure. Go ahead. Search me. What do you think you're going to find? Lisa hiding in my shirt pocket?
Nice watch. A little dainty for you, though, ain't it?
It's Lisa's watch.
Zack insists someone is framing him, and everyone else starts to believe he did it.
Oh, Zack, you fiend! You've murdered my future wife!
Hey, Greed, the quickest way to Zack Morris's heart.
You guys are nuts. I'm telling you, I've been framed.
We'll see.
Zack pieces together how Lisa got out of the room while Screech morphs into Lumeri from Disney's Beauty and the Beast and offers a light at the end of the tunnel when a secret passageway in the fireplace leads back to Steven's office.
Maybe there's a secret passage.
Give me a break, a secret passage. Like if I turn this candle here, the wall's gonna open up.
There is a secret passage.
Please, Zack, don't follow him. He doesn't have a clue.
Oh, come on, my suit is getting off.
Hey, it's Jameson's office.
In Steven's office, they find a drink and a cigarette laced with lipstick.
Hey, it looks like somebody had a party in here.
Yeah, so look at that. Drinks and a cigarette.
Now that's one smoking butt.
I don't know, but one of them left naked.
They also notice a suit hanging on a door. Funny, no one seems to pay attention that it's been quite well maintenance and in orderly fashion since we last saw it.
But someone did change their clothes. And I know who.
Everyone gathers in and Zack reveals whodunit. He reasons that the killer was able to reveal the necklace, rig the axe after Victor and Bartholomew were killed because he know how close they are like cucumber and banana.
But the killer could have planted the watch and necklace on me without an accomplice. Right, Lisa?
Hi, guys.
He realizes the killer needed an accomplice to plant both the necklace and the watch, and that it was Lisa who entered from the secret passage in a fireplace to place the evidence.
Lisa, even dead, you're beautiful.
Okay, we are not blind. We have just seen enough.
Lisa was in on it? Nice going, Zack. How'd you figure it out?
He further points out that the drink in Steven's office was Lisa's, but yet there was another drink that had lipstick on it. The cigarette in the room also had lipstick on it.
Well, I knew how you got out of the bedroom when we found the secret passage, but I didn't know why until we went to Mr. Jameson's office and found this. The only Lisa Turtle drinks a mango tonic with a kiwi twist.
Big surprise, NBC, with the world's worst cross-dressing cop, Tootsie, is actually Steven.
Well, that's right, but she wasn't drinking alone.
That's right. She was drinking with the killer.
But there's lipstick on that glass,
so the killer must be a woman.
Then Jameson was there with Lisa and the other woman.
Found one of Mr. Jameson's cigarettes with lipstick on it. Jameson is the other woman.
Glenn, or Glenda, here was able to change out of his suit and into the dress to play the detective.
I give you our murderer.
A second accomplice had to be included because Steven couldn't have killed both men and steal the necklace at the same time, and the second accomplice is revealed to be none other than Bartholomew.
I'll take that prize money now.
Huh, not so fast, my impetuous friend. You've done well, but I'll take it from here.
There's nothing left to figure out, dork.
Yes, there is. See, Mr. Jameson couldn't have killed the inspector and stolen the necklace at the same time. He must have had a second accomplice. The butler did do it.
You rang, sir?
Wait, Bartholomew was dead. Was George Burns right? Are the gods crazy to have the writers reimagine himself in disguise? Our episode ends in Scooby-Doo fashion with Screech pulling Jeanette's hair, so who she really is because we needed to end on a high point, an upset of WWE's Saved by the Bell Monday Night Raw of Screech abusing women. This was more like mental abuse to humans and to the game of Clue.
And let's see who you really are, Mademoiselle.
Ow! Oops. Oh.